Now our new chapter that we are going to start next is gravitation. My sincere advice to my students out there are, if you are in second year or if you are repeating, my sincere request and advice is finish off electrostatics and then come back to gravitation. Okay, if you are in second year or if you are repeating or if electrostatics is already done from your second year portion, for my students, those who are watching, my sincere request is please watch electrostatics and then come back to this chapter, because both are exactly similar. So when everything is exactly similar, what is the point of repeating everything twice? Okay, in electrostatics you will have charge, in gravitation you will have mass. That's all, no difference will be there. But electrostatic force, it can be attractive or repulsive. Gravitational force is always attractive. Okay, so if you are in second year, and for my students, I usually will not do gravitation first. I will do electrostatics and then I will ask people to do gravitation, and I will do gravitation after I finish off electrostatics only. Okay, in JEE syllabus, current density and capacitors are similar. And your chemistry atomic structure and Bohr's atom in physics, both are same. Photoelectric effect you have in chemistry, you have in modern physics here. Kinetic theory of gases, gaseous state, laws of thermodynamics, even that part is same. So there are similarities between chemistry and physics, but the thing is, in the laws of thermodynamics, instead of plus sign you will have minus sign, that's all. So I want you to have a links, okay, I want you to have links in the subject. But if you are in plus one, okay, if you are in plus one and plus two, they did not start at all, you do this gravitation only. My teaching I will do it in such a way that it will cover, even beginners will understand. But my sincere request is, do not waste your time in doing this chapter, instead do electrostatics and then come back. Okay, because lot of things you will find exactly similar. Okay, instead of charge you will have mass, that's all, nothing else. Okay, so now in gravitation chapter, okay, so in today's class we will be doing Newton's universal law of gravitation as the first part. But first we will start with, okay, what is the idea of field? Okay, what is meant by field? From that I will tell you. Okay, field is, I'll just put it in a simple manner, okay, idea used to explain action at a distance forces. What is this meaning? I'll tell you. Okay, experimentally it was found out that if you have some mass m1 and some other mass m2 like this, okay, Newton's universal law of gravitation, or from this Newton's apple experiment, or why he gave gravity is, okay, from the tree branch, okay, when the apple is falling downwards, okay, just hold on. Hello. 4:30. It will take time. So now, yeah, coming to the Newton. So when the apple is falling down, he told that if you have two masses placed at some distance, earth will have some mass, your apple will have some mass. So why apple is falling on earth means, okay, if you are standing, because we are standing on this, we are seeing that apple is falling down. But apple, because of attraction, apple will come closer to earth will go closer to apple. Okay, both are there. Okay, between two masses there is attractive force. Okay, experimentally it was found out that even in outer space, if you just simply leave two balls, okay, two light balls, they will attract. Why begins? It is because of gravitation. okay, so for electrostatic force, for charge related forces, medium will affect, but in gravitational force there is no effect of medium. So here my point is, experimentally it was found out that, okay, there is attraction. Now if there is attraction, there is no wire in between. So scientists have told that, okay, attraction is the phenomena that they have seen. So what did they tell is, okay, mass m is there, that mass will produce field. Okay, if you take some mass, that mass will produce field. So when a mass produces field, when some other mass enters into field, so here if m1 is acting as the source, my point is, when m1 is producing field everywhere like this, when this m2 comes into field of m1, okay, on this m2 there will be attractive force. Okay, so even though there is no wire, no connection, anything in between, okay, we are seeing some attractive force. To explain the reason for attractive force, scientists have come up with the idea of field. They told that, okay, whenever you have a mass, that mass will produce field. Okay, so that field idea, it is used to explain action at a distance forces. Now we'll do this chapter, okay, we'll do this entire chapter assuming that if you take some mass, that mass will produce field. Okay, now why did I directly start with field? Why not Newton's law of gravitation like everybody do is, okay, I am not doing that because there is a idea, I don't know whether conferences are being held in the last few years, they have held few conferences that existence of gravitational waves. Okay, so wave motion, what it will do is, it will transfer energy and momentum ultimately. So waves, gravitational waves are being sent from source mass to some test mass, something like that, there is some theory, but its existence we will not talk in terms of gravitational waves, we will talk only in terms of field. Okay, field is idea used to explain action at a distance force, I told you, no? So even though there is medium or no medium, somewhere without any physical physical connection, this mass m1 is attracting this mass m2. Even if you keep this m1 fixed, m2 will come close to this. If you leave this, this goes. If you keep this fixed, it comes close. If both are left, both will come close to each other. Okay, so we will do this chapter in terms of field. Okay, in terms of field idea, we will be doing this chapter. So in this chapter, okay, your field idea is, it is used to explain action at a distance forces. And first we will start with field idea only. So now my point is, if you take mass, okay, if you take some mass, this mass, if it is source, it will produce field everywhere. Okay, so gravitational field is caused by mass, point number one. When some test mass comes, okay, when some test mass enters gravitational field of source, it will be attracted by source. It will be attracted by source. Okay, so first, as an introduction, keep this idea in mind. Okay, what is the reason? Field. Field is the reason for causing the force. In this chapter, mass will produce gravitational field. Because of gravitational field, you will have force. Force, potential, energy, everything. Okay, this you remember in and keep it in mind. Now let me start with Newton's universal law of gravitation. Okay, so now This chapter is simple only. I will not complicate it too much. Everything will be direct and pretty clear. I will do it according to electrostatic sequence, not in the book sequence. Okay? So, you need to understand the similarities. So, that is why I should make you feel this chapter to be easy, not tough. So, that is why I will do it in different sequence. Some people will directly start with Kepler's laws. I will not do that way. We will start with basics only. So, now first, your first heading is Newton's universal law of gravitation. Why are we actually using universal law? Means universal law word is used for what? Okay, universal means it is applicable for all the situations. Okay, so now what is your Newton's universal law is, if you take two point masses, if you take some point mass m1 here and some other mass m2 here, I have told you field of m1 will cause force on 2, field of 2 will cause force on 1. So we will look at force separately, but for now there will be on m1 attractive force will be this way. On M2 attractive force will be this way. From here to here, if the distance is R, okay, your points, okay, what Newton gave is your magnitude of force, magnitude of gravitational force. I am not talking of direction, I am talking of magnitude. Okay, mod will indicate magnitude. Your gravitational force magnitude, these two are equal, but they are opposite. I will come to that. We have to always talk of force on a body, field at a point, okay, potential at a point, energy for a system. So here, whenever you talk of force, if you take these two together as a system, gravitational force will become internal force and net force is zero. There is no external force. Whenever we are talking of gravitational force on which body, you have to always talk of force on a body. If you are talking of force because of the system, on the system, it is net force. If you are taking these two together as system, your net force is zero. So I am talking of the magnitude. Here first I will talk of magnitude, then I will come to each individual part. So your gravitational force is directly proportional to m1, m2. It is inversely proportional to R square. So, removing this proportionality constant, your gravitational force magnitude is between two point masses. It is G M1 M2 by R square. Okay. It is directly proportional to product of masses and it is inversely proportional to square of the distance. So, your gravitational force is G M1 M2 by R square, where your G value is universal gravitational constant. G is universal gravitational constant and its value is G is equal to 6.67 into 10 power minus 11. Coming to the unit part, for this force unit is Newton, for this part it is kg, for this part also it is kg, for this part it is meters. So you will get Newton meter square. Your unit is Newton meter square per kg square. Okay. So dimensional formula, if it is asked, accordingly you substitute it. Okay. So between two point masses which are like this, the gravitational force magnitude is this much. Now coming to the direction and properties, I will write here the important properties. Okay. Let's not waste too much time on this. So the properties are, okay, point number one, this formula is applicable only to point charges, okay, point masses, okay. If I am using the word charge, I am sorry, I am referring to mass. It is applicable only to point mass, okay, point masses, okay. Next, acts along line joining the masses. Acts along line joining masses. Okay. So that means between M1 and M2, if you are joining with help of a straight line, So it lacked along the line joining these two masses. Next, third point is, okay, it acts along the line joining the masses. Next, your third point is, okay, always attractive. Okay, electric force, it can be attractive or repulsive, but gravitational force, it is attractive. So always attractive, it is independent of medium. It is independent of medium. Independent of medium means, okay, in vacuum, for example, if you take electrostatic force, your electrostatic force in vacuum, it is different. In water, it is different. In a different liquid, it is different. But your gravitational force in water, if you are placing at some distance, your gravitational force in water will be same as gravitational force in vacuum. Okay, so F vacuum is equal to F liquid under same distance. Okay, if you keep at same distance, same mass and distance, if you keep, okay, for same mass and distance, your magnitude of force will not change. Okay, first consider this as my introduction. Okay, I have explained field. Field will cause force. Okay, in this chapter, field idea is important. Okay, your mass is the cause for field. That field, whenever into that field some charged particle enters, some mass particle enters, there will be some force. That force is always attractive. It acts along the line joining the masses. It is independent of medium, and it is applicable only to, this law or formula is applicable only to point masses. Okay, so only for point masses you can apply this, and for other systems you cannot apply this. Okay, right? So keep these things in mind and do not mix different things. Okay, copy it. I am waiting. Okay, then put a note. Later in second year you will get clarity, but for now I will not elaborate much, but in the field part I will discuss certain ideas. So for big masses, you can assume if they are far, okay, out of, for big masses, big sphere and all, if they are far enough, the distance between them, if it is like, if you have m1 and m2, if you have some radius r1 and r2 like this, if this distance is d, is very much big compared to the radius, then also you can apply this gravitational force. Okay, so gravitational force formula, F equal to gm1 m2 by r square, is valid, okay, if those radius are very big compared to distances also. But for big masses, while solving problems, we will consider entire mass to be concentrated at center of mass, and then we will do the questions. So that I will explain now, don't worry. Okay, now I will come to the further elaboration. So gm1 m2 by r square is your gravitational force between two point masses m1 and m2. Okay, right. Now let's continue. Okay, now your next thing is, for this M1 and M2 system, I told you we have to be very specific with the force, because advanced level questions you will not be able to do it if you understand these ideas wrongly. So force on one, force on two. Okay, so this explanation is important. I'll write it this way: on M1, on M2, on mass M1 and on mass M2. Let us say this point is x1, y1, z1. This point coordinates are x2, y2, z2. Now if you take this vector as r bar, okay, if you are taking the position vector this way, if it is r bar, your r cap will be your unit vector. So your r bar will be x2 minus x1 I cap. If they give you simple questions, you should be able to link this y2 minus y1 j cap plus z2 minus z1 k cap. Okay, that is your position vector. Your r cap is r bar by mod r. Okay, if you do not know this, go to vector chapter. Okay, now they'll ask you force magnitude. So I am differentiating. First, I told you we have to talk of force on a body. So on M1, on M2. So on M1, force is caused by field of M2. Field of M2 will cause force on M1. Its own field cannot cause force on itself. Okay, M1, if it is the source, M1 will, if it is, I mean, obviously M1 will produce field. So its own field cannot cause force on itself. Okay, so on M1, okay, force is caused by field of M2. Okay, on M2, force is caused by, okay, caused by field of M1. Okay, I'll write force, gravitational force on M2, gravitational force on M1. Okay, gravitational force on M1 is caused by field of M2, gravitational force on M2 is caused by field of M1. Okay, and right now, next, your force magnitude is gravitational force on 1 by 2 is g m1 m2 by r square, direction is right. Okay, it always acts along the line joining the top particles, so that is why it is towards right. Your gravitational force on 2 by 1, if you take, it is g m1 m2 by r square, its direction is left. Okay, on to by field of m1, its own field cannot cause force on itself. Some other mass, source mass, okay, will produce field, that field will cause force. Next, it can also be written as, your right direction can also be written as gm1 by r square into r cap. Okay, r cap will indicate right direction. This indicates right direction. Your left direction can also be written as gm1 m2 by r square times minus r cap. Okay, now what is r cap? R bar by mod r. So that will give you gm1 m2 by r cube into r bar, so that your r cube by r is r cap. Okay, or this can also be written as minus g m1 m2 by r cube into r bar. Okay, if r bar is used, denominator cube. Okay, r bar, if it is used, r cube. If r cap is used, in the denominator it is r square. Okay, r is just simply right. Okay, now in vectors, you know how to write the vector in terms of I cap and j cap, right? So using that, we will do something. Okay, so this is your more information on the Newton's universal law of gravitation. Okay, copy this stuff down. I will continue further. Next, I hope you have copied this stuff down. Let me continue. Now, you need to understand how this form is related to mass, weight, difference, everything you need to understand. So, let me tell you how gravitational force will act, I will tell you. Now, if you take sun, if it is at center for example, your earth, what it will do is, it will revolve, it will spin around its own axis and simultaneously it will revolve around the sun. Now, normally, according to Kepler's laws, your earth revolves around the sun in elliptical orbits. For now, let's just take circular orbit, okay? Except in the Kepler's laws part, nowhere we consider elliptical orbits, okay? We'll always consider the circular orbits and then we'll do the questions, okay? So, for orbital motion of satellites, everything we'll consider circular motion, not the elliptical motion, okay? For JE syllabus point of view. In real time experiments everywhere, you have to consider elliptical thing only. But for now, let's just keep it simple. So, your mass of sun, if you keep it as capital MS, mass of earth, if you keep it as small me, distance between them from center to center, let us say it is some r. Now, if it is going in circle with some velocity v, or angular velocity omega, okay, right? Now, if you take this, your sun-earth thing, your omega is 2 pi by time period. So, earth revolves around the sun in around 365 or 366 days. So, in omega 2 pi by time period, you have to keep 365 or 366. That part I will come later. But now, let us look at the logical aspect. So, if the distance is r, your gravitational force on earth will be this way. So, your gravitational force, this body is going in circular path. So, because it is going in circular path, your gravitational force is equal to mv square by r, okay, small r, not the radius of earth. You should not take radius of earth, it is the distance from sun to earth, which is also equal to me into r into omega square. Okay, they'll ask you simple questions related to this, so that is why I'm explaining. So, what is your gravitational force? Capital G into mass of sun times mass of earth by r square, inverse square law. Okay, it is applicable only for point masses. So, compared to the radius of earth, distance between sun and earth is very big. So, that is why I can apply this formula. So, GMS into me by r square is equal to me into v square by r or m r omega square, that is your choice. Me will cancel off, okay? So, 1 r will cancel off. Your velocity in the orbit is under root universal gravitational constant times mass of sun by radius r. Your v is also equal to r times omega, okay? Which is r times omega is 2 pi by t. T is time period, how much time your earth takes to revolve around the sun once. Okay, so on this you will have simple questions. Okay, they will ask you to find out angular velocity. Omega is the angular velocity. Okay, if you have watched my circular motion video, you will get the value of omega. Okay, so based on this, some simple questions will be there. You just do those. Omega is 2 pi by time period. Okay, based on this, some simple questions you do it. Okay, right. Now, let's continue further. Next, now I need to explain your difference between weight and mass first. I have explained in already. I have explained it already in Newton's laws of motion, but still, okay, I will not waste much time. Mass, weight. Okay. Now, we are writing gravitational force as, according to Newton's law, it is gm1 m2 by r square. Now, this is between two point mass. Now, if you take mass of Earth as me, some object's mass as m here, let us say the distance is some r here. Okay. Now, here, if you try to apply two formulas, one is gm into m by r square. This you can also write it as, if you are writing gravitational force as mg, mm will cancel off. What is g means? Acceleration due to gravity. You will get it as gme by r square. Okay, this is your acceleration due to gravity. So this acceleration due to gravity, g depends on depth, height, everywhere. Okay, where your second mass is present. Okay, I will come to acceleration due to gravity topic separately, but for now understand that. Okay, right? I mean, we are writing gravitational force as mg, right? So that only I have equated to gm and m2 by r square. Okay, inverse square law. So g into me into m by r square, I am equating it to mg. From here, g is gme by r square. Okay, now what is r? Distance from center of earth to that point mass. Okay, so from this point mass, if it is at depth d, it will be different. If it is at height, it will be different. I will come to that part later. But for now, understand that, okay, your g, okay, your weight is mass times acceleration due to gravity g. Okay, now that g will depend on, okay, for now understand that, remember this point, okay, don't get confused. For now, g depends on, okay, acceleration due to gravity depends on, okay, depth from surface of earth, okay, height from surface. Next, it could even be because of rotation of earth. It will also get affected by rotation of earth, with what angular velocity it spins accordingly. Next, it also depends on latitude. Lot of factors are there. Okay, so in India if it is something, in US it will be different, in Canada it will be different, in Antarctica it will be different, in Australia it will be different, in New Zealand it is different, everywhere g is different. Okay, so now here let's come to this part. What is mass? Amount of matter contained in the body. Okay, this you will study in books. Okay, now what is the unit? Kg. Okay, right, mass unit is kg. Now what is weight? Weight is amount of gravitational force. Weight is amount of gravitational force acting on body. Okay, so your gravitational force is m into g. Now its unit is Newton. Okay, and 1 kg weight word, if it is used, it is equal to 10 newton. Kg weight is also unit of force. Okay, so now if you come, if you take some 6 kg mass, that 6 kg mass will have same mass in earth and same mass in moon, but weight is different. Okay, on earth if you take, okay, mass, if you are taking it as 6 kg, okay, your weight is m into g, that is 6 into g value is 10, 60 newton on earth. But if you take on moon, okay, as an example I am telling you, mass will still remain the same 6 kg, but weight is mass times acceleration due to gravity of moon. Okay, your mass is 6 times acceleration due to gravity of moon is, it will be 1/3 of 6, g earth by 6, g value is approximately 10, So 6 by 6 will go off, it will go, it will show only 10 Newton. That is 10 Newton is 1 kg weight. Okay. And 60 Newton is 6 kg weight. Okay. In the shops, okay, we are actually measuring weight only, not the mass. If you have watched my Newton's laws of motion, you will see that what is the apparent weight and real weight. Okay. So even though we are using the word kg, it is different. So hope you got the difference between mass and weight. Okay. Let's not waste much time. Anywhere if you see weight, okay, it is m into g. So from that you can get the value of m. Okay. Now in the problems, if any questions are asked giving weight instead of mass, first you have to get the mass by doing this calculation, and then you have to use it in the problems. Okay. Right. Next. In the last part of this lecture, okay, your principle of superposition of forces. Let me check whether any time is left or not. Yeah, there is some time. All right. So your principle of superposition of forces. After this, I'll immediately jump into problems. Now what it says is, if you have multiple masses at different points, R1, R2, at some other R3 there is some other mass M3, at R4 some M4 like this, and if there is some test mass M, okay, some R5 like this. Now each force will attract this M. So because of M1, force is this way. Because of M2, force is this way. Because of M3, force F3 is this way. Because of M4, force F4 is this way. Because of M5, your force is this way. So your resultant force, F resultant, is okay, F1 bar plus F2 bar plus F3 bar plus F4 bar plus F5 bar plus so on is your resultant force. Okay. So vectorial addition you have to do it. Now how will you do it? Write each vector in terms of I cap and J cap. Okay. And add all the corresponding X components and add all the corresponding Y components and then do it. Okay. Those who do not know how to calculate this I cap J cap thing, please watch my vectors video. Okay, you can stop this video, go to vectors playlist, open that. Okay, learn how to write each vector in terms of I cap and J cap, and then come back to this part. So your resultant force is, vector addition if you do, you have to add all the X components, you have to add all the Y components. Finally, you will get some X component I cap plus Y component J cap. To get the magnitude, your resultant force is, your magnitude of resultant force is under root X component square plus Y component square, and your tan alpha is equal to Y component by X component. Okay. So this is your principle of superposition of forces. Okay. Right. So please do learn this writing in terms of I cap and J cap. Now I'll explain with help of an example. So let us start. Hope you have copied this thing down. Your first question is, you have three identical masses placed at sides of equilateral triangle, point masses. Okay, distance is d, identical masses. D, there is some point O at the center. Okay. What is your question is, I am placing capital M. Find net force on capital M. Okay. Find net force on capital M. That is your question. Okay, it is at the centroid. So now to calculate the distance between those two points and angles, first you have to take this. This angle will be 90 degrees, this will be 30, this will be 60 degrees. So first you apply cos 30. Cos 30 is adjacent side d by 2y, hypotenuse, that is y. Cos 30 is root 3 by 2. So root 3 by 2 is equal to d by 2y. 2 will cancel off, y is d by root 3. So that means this distance is how much? D by root 3. Next, come to this part. Sin 30, tan 30 you have to take. Tan 30 is opposite side. 1 by root 3 is equal to x by d by 2. So send it to other side. D by 2 root 3 is equal to x. Now we have got the values of x and y. Okay, and this angle is 60 degrees. Now, pause the video clip if you do not get sufficient time to try. Okay, first you pause the video, try it. So if you take this mass as 1, 2, 3, okay, and if you draw the axis here, so what is that you are going to have? Your forces will be this way. Force because of 3, your F3 is G times capital M into small m by y square. Your force because of 1 will be this way, making an angle of 60 degrees. How much is its value? Means g times capital M into small m by y square. Force because of 2 is g times capital M into small m by y square. This angle is also 60 degrees. Okay, so now you have calculate, F1, F2, F3, how much is y? Means d by root 3. Different mass also, you can apply the same logic. So y, we are getting it as d by root 3. Keep this aside. Now, I hope I can erase this. Okay, so which I will do now. Okay, pause the video clip, try it. Without trying, just don't keep watching. Whenever I am writing a question, just keep in mind that you have to pause the video clip. As soon as I finish off the question, give it a try, then you continue the video. Okay, to save time and space, I am continuing it. That's all. So your force F1 vector is, okay, let us say your GMM by y square, you take it as some F0. So this will also be F0. This will also be F0. So it is in third quadrant. So for a vector in third quadrant, you will have negative x and negative y. So it will become minus f0 sin 60 I cap plus, sorry, minus f0 cos 60 j cap. Okay, please, I am requesting you, if you do not follow something in this lecture, please go to my vectors, and in that, in one of the videos, I have explained very clearly how to write a vector in terms of I, j, k. So very important for physics. So you must learn this. Next, your force F2 vector is, okay, your F2 is in fourth quadrant. In fourth quadrant, you will have positive x and negative y. So minus f naught sine 60 I cap, sorry, plus, okay, positive x and negative y, minus f naught cos 60 j cap. Your vector f3 bar is, it is along y axis, so 0 I cap plus f naught j cap because it is along positive y axis. So your resultant force is, f resultant is, okay, f naught sin 60 plus f naught sin 60 minus f naught sin 60 will cancel out when you are adding these two, plus f naught cos 60 is 1 by 2, cos 60 is 1 by 2. So it is f naught minus f naught by 2 minus f naught by 2. Eventually this term also becomes 0. So your resultant force in this case is 0. I cap plus 0 j cap, which is a null vector. Okay. So null vector means 0 magnitude. Okay. Null vector will have 0 magnitude. Okay. Right. Next. Let's move ahead to the next question. Basic questions, you will be able to do it. Okay. Don't struggle. Try it sincerely. You will get the answers. Okay. Your next question is, writing the vector in terms of I cap and J cap is important, and deciding on which particle we are writing the force, that is important. So your next application is, you have mass M here, one more mass M, this distance is 8D. One more mass M here, one more mass M here. Let us say it is capital M. 8D, 8D, 6D, 6D. Okay. What is your question is, find F resultant on capital M. Find resultant force on capital M. Okay. Right, you are supposed to give the resultant force on capital M. Okay, now here let us try to solve this question. Okay, first always remember 6, 8, 10 combination. If you see in this right angle triangle, 10 is the hypotenuse, this part is 6, this part is 8. Side opposite to 6 will be 37 degrees. Side opposite to this is 53 degrees. Okay. Your sin 37, cos 53, both are 3 by 5. Sin 53, cos 37, both are 4 by 5. So 6, 8, 10 combination, if you see, get this part, get this angles first. Okay. It should immediately strike to your mind. Okay. So once it strikes to your mind, it will not be a tough job at all. So now I hope you have paused the video and tried this, and now you are continuing. Okay. So I will continue. So now here, if I do that, let me number this 1, 2, 3. On capital M, how many forces will be there? Means, because of 1, attraction, because of 2, attraction, because of 3, attraction. So if I mark the axis like this, okay, now my first force will be, because of 1, okay, it is this way, G into capital M into small m by, how much is the distance? 8d whole square, which is 64d square. So let G capital M small m by d square is equal to f naught, because every time writing G capital M small m, it will just kill lot of your time. So it is just simply f naught by 64. It is along negative x axis. Next, if you join these two, m2, this 2 will attract capital M this way. How much is the distance? Means this will become 10d. This angle, as I have discussed, it is how much? It is on opposite side. 8 is on opposite side. It is 53 degrees. Relax. Okay? Right? This angle will be 37. This angle is 53. So, your F2 is, it will make 53 degrees angle. How much is your F2 means? It is G into capital M into small m by 10D whole square is 100D square. That is equal to F0 by 100. Angle is 53. Third, this M3 will attract this way downwards. So, it is F3. Okay. So, your F3 will act this way. So, what is your F3 value means? It is G into capital M into small m by 60 whole square. So, that is F0 by 36. Okay. Right. It is downwards. Now, write each vector in terms of I cap and J cap and then add it. So, your first vector F1 bar is, it is along negative x axis. So, minus F0 by 64 I cap plus 0 J cap. F2 bar is, it is in third quadrant, negative x and negative y, minus F0 by 100 sin 53 I cap minus F0 by 100 cos 53 J cap. Third one is F3 bar is equal to 0 I cap because it is along negative x axis minus F0 by 36 J cap. Okay. So, because it is downwards, add the corresponding x components. Sin 53, I have told you it is 4 by 5. Add the corresponding y components and finish it off. You will get the answer. Once you get this, your magnitude is, once you get this x component I cap plus y component J cap, your magnitude is under root x component square plus y component square will give you the magnitude of force. Okay. Like this you are supposed to give the answers. Okay. Basic questions you will be able to do it. You have to try this sincerely. That's all. Okay. Right. Next. Now, next we will see a simple question. Now, your gravitational force we have seen only because of point masses. So far in what I have explained, we have seen gravitational force only because of point masses. Okay. Now, we will see gravitational force because of extended object. Okay. So, now, let us say you have a mass. Okay. I hope you have done center of mass, moment of inertia. If not, application of integration in physics, how to take small strips, I have explained. So, your question is, there is a thin rod whose mass is M, length is L. There is some point P here, whose at this point P, there is a small mass. From here to here, the distance is D. What is your question is, find gravitational force on small m. That is your question. Okay. Now here, these kind of questions, okay, how to take strip and integrate, that if you do, it is the best. Okay. Now, extended objects, I will explain later. Okay. But for now, okay, for formality sake, okay, in the first part itself, if for the test, if questions come, you must be able to do it right in the books. So, that is why I am explaining this. Now, your formula of gm1 m2 by r square is valid only for point masses. Okay, only for point masses, gm1 m2 by r square is valid. But now, here you have an extended object. This extended object is having mass not concentrated at a single point. It is having mass along the entire length. And in this too, if mass is changing, as you keep coming from here to here or here to here, if that mass is changing everywhere, it will be different. Okay. So, that variable mass integration part, I will take care later. But for now, let us say it is a uniform rod. I am giving in the question itself, there is a uniform rod. Okay. In the problem solving sessions, I will try to cover more, not here. Okay. But now, in this uniform rod, I mean, for me to apply GM1 M2 by R square, it is valid only for point masses. For this object, I cannot do that. Then, what can I do here is, if I take a small part here, somewhere at some distance, some small part at some distance x, this small mass dm if I take, okay, now your small gravitational force, this small mass dm is a point mass. So g times dm into m by x square will give you small force. Okay, for entire body I cannot apply f equal to gm1 m2 by r square, but for two small point masses I can apply that. So what is it I am doing? I am taking a small point mass in this mass. If I do so, I will get small mass df is equal to g times dm into m by x square. Now, important part, look here. M, capital M mass is having length L. Okay, dm mass, if it is having dx, this is direct proportionality. More mass, more length. Small mass, small length. Because it is directly proportional part, m times dx is equal to dm into L. From here, your small mass dm is m by l into dx. In fact, it is called as lambda into dx, where lambda is linear mass density. Okay, your m by l is called linear mass density. Lambda equal to m by l is linear mass density. Okay, mass per unit length. Okay, right. Now, if I come back to this, you, to get the total force, what is that you are supposed to do? You are supposed to integrate df, that is integral of g times, what is dm? M by lambda into dx, that is m by l into dx times small mass is m by x square, where x is varying from, you have to suppose, you are always supposed to take limit such that entire body is covered. So if x is equal to d, your strip will be at right end. X is equal to d plus n, your strip will be at left end, so that your entire body is covered. Now coming to the direction part, obviously two masses will attract each other, so your force on small m is towards left and on the rod it is towards right. So if you simplify this, constants can be taken out of the integral, g times capital M into small m by l times integral of dx by x square from d to d plus l. Okay, so that will give you g capital M small m by l times x power minus 2 plus 1 by minus 2 plus 1 from d to d plus l. Okay, so that will give you g capital M small m by l times minus 1 by x from d to d plus l. Let me simplify it further. I think I can erase this. Okay. So, if I erase this, I hope you have copied these things down and nothing is left off. Okay, for my students, I will check your notes. If you skip anything, I will kill you. Okay, d to d plus l. So, which will give you your gravitational force as g capital M small m minus, I will take it out, by l times 1 by d plus l minus 1 by d. So that will give you minus g capital M small m by l times d minus d plus l minus l by d times d plus l, minus minus will become plus, ll will cancel off, g capital M small m by d times d plus l is your final gravitational force. Okay, so like this you are supposed to do it. Okay, later in the next part when we are doing gravitation field, you will get very good amount of clarity. Okay, so actually what we are supposed to do is, for these kind of configurations, your force is mass times gravitational field. Okay, so you will calculate field, this is the best approach. You will calculate field, you multiply with whatever mass, you keep m 1 kg, 2 kg, 10 kg, it doesn't matter. Because of this, how much is the field you will calculate, and you will multiply it with whatever mass you are placing it there. Okay, so with this we will stop the first lecture.
Okay, that's all for this class. Thank you.